We're glad you're here today. You know, we celebrated last weekend Easter. Who all was here for Easter? Yeah? Yeah, it was such a blast. You know, it was good to celebrate with the confetti and with partying together a little bit. It's really good. And this week, as we start again, we're just starting back with the simple pursuit of Jesus. That's what we do each week, right? So we're going to start by just singing this familiar chorus, the song we've sung for years and years. Just coming back to that same heart, just pursuing Jesus, adoring Him. Sing, I'm coming back.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about You. It's all about You, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about You, yeah, it's all about You.
Let it be a prayer of your heart right here.
I'm coming back to heart of worship, when it's all about You, Lord, it's all about You, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about You, and it's all about You.
Sing, it's all about You, just like that.
It's all about You. It's all about You, Jesus. Yeah, it's all about You. It's all about You.
There's a reason we're here, God.
Taylor, let's go ahead and read that scripture from Psalm 145. Go ahead and lead us, Taylor.
Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. And His greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend Your works to another and shall declare Your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of Your majesty and on Your wondrous works, I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of Your awesome deeds, and I will declare Your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of Your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of Your righteousness.
Thank you. Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Dave Learned. I serve as one of the pastors at our Rolling Meadows campus. Really, really glad that you joined us today. You know, we would absolutely love to know, where are you watching from today? So you can let us know in the chat or in the comments. And if this is your first time with us, please tell us. I'm so glad you chose to join us at Harvest today. Hey, whether you're new, maybe first week, or whether you come every week, we want to invite you to check in. You can do it right on this page. You can do it through the link in the comments that you'll find on YouTube and Facebook, or through the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We'd love to know that you're here. We also want to know how we can pray for you this week. We count it a huge privilege to be able to come alongside you and to pray with you about things that are going on in your life that are on your heart. I also want you to know that as we worship together, giving is a part of worship. And so listen to what 2 Corinthians 9 verse 7 says. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion. For God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. If you're not a guest, we want to invite you to engage in worshiping the Lord through giving. And there's various ways you can do that. You can give online right on this page. You can also hold up your camera on your phone to the QR code, and it'll take you right to a page where you can give and give an offering. You can also give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, through a text, or mailing a check to our Rolling Meadows campus. In all of this, we worship the Lord through our giving. Hey, before we get too far away from Easter Sunday, we want to take a quick look back at some of the things the Lord did in our church last weekend. Watch this.
Come on, we have something to celebrate today, don't we?
Shout it out, He is risen. Our God is alive. Now everybody dance till the kingdom come. Everybody shout till the walls fall down. We will never stop, we will never stop, because we are free.
Just like that, come on, one, two.
Everybody dance till the kingdom come. Everybody shout till the walls fall down. We will never stop, we will never stop, because we are.
Love it. It was so great to be able to worship together for Good Friday and for Easter. Hey, tonight, Sunday night, April 11th, if you have a student in junior high or high school, I want to invite you to get them engaged with our student ministry. We have an all-campus event tonight that's called Second Sunday, April 11th, 5 to 7 p.m., and it's on the Rolling Meadows campus. You don't want to miss this. There's a lot of important information at harvestnow.info, but we want to invite your students to engage with Second Sunday tonight. And our elders have called us to a day of fasting and prayer. It's coming up this Wednesday, April 14th. We want to invite you, as you're able, to fast and pray throughout the day. And then at 7 o'clock that night, on each of our campuses, we're going to have an in-person prayer gathering. And there will be an online option to that as well. We really want to seek the Lord together as we ask God to provide leadership as we seek a lead teaching pastor for our church, and to pray together in that. So again, all the details you can find at harvestnow.info. Hey, today in our message, we're going to return to the book of Ephesians. Dr. Michael Rydelnik is preaching, and he's bringing a message entitled A Prayer Guide for Spiritual Growth, and it's from Ephesians 1, verse 15 to 23. Let's read that passage now together. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation, in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you. What are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him his head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Thank you, Lord, for your word. I can't wait to hear the message today. Hey, would you join me as we pray? Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity. We never want to take for granted an opportunity to worship you. So Lord, wherever each person is today, Lord, help us to engage with you, to hear from you, to respond to you, because you're worthy of our worship and our praise. Receive our songs, receive the preaching of your word, receive these gifts, these offerings, all of it, Lord, for your name and your glory. Together we pray these things today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our Father.
Our Father in heaven, the light of salvation. Oh, how good is he, the breath almighty, before, behind. Oh, how good is he. Everything with everything.
Salvation of God, right? It's good, it's good, it's good. Every good and perfect gift comes from the Lord. Everything we have that is good, everything that we have that is beneficial to us or is good for our souls is directly from our Father in heaven. Amen. Well, hey, we're going to watch a testimony of God's goodness in the life of someone in our church. Let's go ahead and take a seat. Let's turn our attention to the screens and let's watch this.
Hi, my name is Raquel. I attend the Elgin campus, and this is my son, AJ. He'll be 12 this year. I came to Harvest in 2014. My kids were part of Harvest Kids in Elgin, and we'd go to summer camp every summer, right? That was the highlight of his summer was going to camp. The kid, he always loved it. He was play wrestling with dad one day and he ended up with a lump. So we took him to immediate care center and the x-rays confirmed that it was a tumor. My whole world just turned upside down that day. Right soon after that, therapy started and, you know, all the chemo treatments and the biopsies and surgeries. And as treatments went on, I did have moments when I didn't know if he was gonna make it. I would just cry while he was sleeping, or I'd have to step out of the room and cry. I felt like it was just never gonna end. I just know that I prayed and I prayed and I prayed. I would open my Bible and just read whatever I could just to encourage me. You know, I'd have family and friends calling me and praying with me. That meant so much to me. Pastor Britt reached out. Actually, I, you know, after service one day, asked Pastor Britt, Pastor Tommy, if they would pray over AJ, and they prayed over him, and that just made me feel so loved, you know? So AJ ended up having a total knee replacement, right, in November. They took out his tumor, and it was sent to the lab, and that was, it came back with it being necrosis number being 90%, which means it was 90% dead. The chemo was working. He was so happy, right? He was so happy that he was gonna be done with treatment. I mean, he was counting down the minutes, and he was even singing happy birthday to himself, just because he was like, you know, I get my life back. You know, I get to be a kid again. It was hard still because, you know, that's when COVID started, when his treatments ended. We decided we'd have a car parade for him, you know, to have family and friends come by and, you know, wave. And I had a cousin who shared it on Facebook, and it just got shared like, I don't know how many times. And I mean, EPD was involved, the fire department was involved. We had a set of motorcycle bikers come through. I mean, he had all sorts, and like, that was a really exciting day, right, AJ?
Yeah.
That he had gotten so much love from people that didn't even know him as well. The doctor basically told us that what they were gonna do is check up on him every 3 months to make sure his cancer didn't grow back. So every 3 months for the past year, AJ has been getting MRIs and CT scans done. And so far, thank the Lord above, they've all been coming back clean. I think God wanted to teach me not to rely on what I can control. God wanted me to learn, like, hey, I got this. You know, he wanted me to give him the control. We found AJ this shirt, and the verse we chose was Isaiah 41:10. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. We chose that verse because God truly was our rock in the midst of this terrible storm that we went through. And he helped me as a mom to be strong for my kids. And it was with God's hand that all of us got through such a trying time in our lives.
Yeah, why don't you stand to your feet as we continue?
You're still healing.
Lord, there is no one like you. No one else could have done what you did for us. No one else can do what you do. That you bring salvation. You bring forgiveness to anyone who calls on your name, the name of your son, Jesus. So God, today, before we move on from this moment, Lord, we ask, where there is brokenness, would you bring healing? Would you do that, God? Where there is such weariness, God, would you just be the lifter of their heads today? Where there are some where they've just lost hope, God, would you just renew their hope today? Remind them, God, that you're trustworthy, that you're ever present. Lord, we thank you for your church. Thank you that we can gather in this place today, God, and come to you just as we are. Thank you for your presence and your Holy Spirit. That is such a gift to us, Lord. We ask that you would move in our hearts. Would your Spirit speak to us through your word? We love you, Lord. We pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Amen. So good to worship together today, Harvest. Amen.
Good morning, Harvest. Morning. To all the campuses watching right now, so glad to see you. I can't see you, you can see me, but still, I'm really glad that we're all together. We are really still coming down off the excitement of celebrating the resurrection of our Lord. So, but I said just a moment ago, how do I go and speak now from the word after hearing a testimony like that? I mean, that was so powerful about God's control. Of course, you know, I'm trying to wipe my eyes and get ready to get up here and speak, but God's word is going to speak into our hearts today as well. But that was just so powerful, and I'm so grateful to God for AJ's well-being. So, okay. Well, when I was a kid, I think I may have mentioned that I thought I was going to be tall. We had this wall in my house where we were measured every year. And I remember my bar mitzvah. I stood there against the wall. I was 5'2", but I had really big hands. And everyone said, you're going to be really tall. Then when I turned 14, I went for my measurement, 5'8", 6 inches in 1 year. I thought, this is so cool, because at that point, I was the tallest Rydelnik in the history of Rydelniks. And I thought, I've got 4 more years to grow, because you grow until you're 18. I'm going to be over 6 feet tall. I might even be in the NBA. I don't know. And then I never grew another inch. I never grew another quarter of an inch. In fact, now I'm in real trouble because I'm starting to shrink. It's very disappointing. You know, you go to the doctor for your annual checkup, and they put down your height, and I go, no, that's not right, I'm 5'8". And the nurse looks at you and says, no, you're not. So, but when it comes to spiritual growth, there should never be a time when we stop growing. I mean, it's something that is going to start from the day that we come to faith in Jesus and trust in him until we see him face to face. Spiritual growth should never end. I mean, think about the Apostle Paul. I mean, he was a spiritual giant. And what does he say in Philippians chapter 3? Not that I have arrived or that I'm perfect. I mean, here's a guy that is way more mature spiritually than I will ever be, and he still wants to keep growing. We all should want to keep growing in our walk, and that's what we're going to talk about today, how to pray for spiritual growth, a prayer guide for spiritual growth. In Ephesians 1, 15 through 23, Paul prays for the continued spiritual progress of the Ephesians. He is praying for them to grow. So I guess what we could do is we could say, this is how we should pray for others, but it's a good model for anyone to pray for spiritual growth. And so why not use Paul's guide for praying for the Ephesians as our own prayer guide for how we should pray for our continued spiritual growth? So that's what we're going to look at. Let's make sure we get this in context. We're learning all about our eternal portfolio in the book of Ephesians and how to live in light of that eternal portfolio. And the first three chapters of Ephesians deal with our wealth that we have. And then chapters 4 and 5 deal with our walk. And then chapter 6 deals with our warfare. And so that's sort of a big picture of it. And in our wealth, we've already looked at the riches of redemption at the first part. And then that's the first major section. That's what we've finished already. But there's sort of a little prayer interlude for that, those riches of redemption to be understood and applied and lived in right here in Ephesians 1, 15 through 23. So that's where we're at. And what I'd like to do is read that. And if you get out your Bible, that would be really helpful. And I am so happy to see all the real Bibles here. So get out those real Bibles. And if you have to take out your phone, do that. But let's all stand. I'm going to read. You follow along. Let's honor God's word as we read it. We're going to read Ephesians 1, 15 through 23. Ephesians 1, 15 through 23. I hear pages turning. I'm going to wait. You keep going there. Isn't that weird to have silence? It's okay. We're not on the radio. You know, I do radio. If you pause for 2 seconds, they're ready to take you off. So, for this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus, the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ, when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. You can have a seat. There are three principles, I think, of prayer that we find in this for praying for spiritual growth. Here's the first one. When praying, we should thank God for the spiritual maturity he's already granted us. We should thank God for what he's already done in our lives. We should thank God. That's the first step of praying for spiritual growth, is to thank God for what he has already done. If you look here in verse 15, it says, for this reason. Well, what reason does he mean? He means what he has just talked about, generally to the benefits described in verses 3 through 14, the riches of redemption that we have from the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, but more specifically to verses 13 and 14, to the Holy Spirit, who is our seal and pledge. For this reason, he says, he gives thanks And that's what he's doing. He's thanking God for the spiritual benefits that they already have. It's what we ought to do. We ought to be thanking God for all the spiritual benefits he's already given us. And then, so I think it's a good idea, add up our wealth, say, oh, wow, I'm thankful. And then it says in verses 15 and 16, 15b, it picks up there, it says we're thankful for not just these benefits, but the behavior that he has already changed, the spiritual behavior. You could see it here. He says, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints. He's thankful, and we should be thankful when we pray for what he's done already, what he has done. The Ephesians were a spiritually mature congregation. And therefore, they already had faith, which is they trusted in the Messiah Jesus and were trusting in him and walking along with him. And then they also had love for their fellow believers. They were caring and concerned and acting towards the benefit of the believers. So their vertical relationship was right, their faith in the Lord Jesus, and their horizontal relationships were right. They were already growing. And so what Paul is saying is that when you pray for spiritual growth, start off by thanking God for what he has already done. We can look at our lives, can't we, and be grateful for what God has done for us in our walk with him and our concern for others. So often what we do is we just take for granted and we even ignore what God has already done. We just feel so miserable with ourselves that we don't see that God has done anything. I had forgotten what it's like to raise kids, but now I have grandkids. And the funniest thing is to watch toddlers when they want juice, or they want milk, or they want a cookie, or oatmeal, you name it. This is what they do. I want oatmeal, right? And then you give them oatmeal. And then you say, and what do you say? And they look at you like, can I have brown sugar? No, that's not what you say. Say thanks. So often we're looking to the next thing that we want that we forget to say thanks for what God has given us. We forget to say thank you. One of the things that I loved, I went to a school and there was a professor there named Zane Hodges. And I didn't always agree with what Prof. Hodges said, but he was a great teacher. And one of the things that I loved about his class that I've tried to emulate and have failed miserably at doing is the way he gave tests. Because when he gave a test, you celebrated all you had learned. You didn't feel badly about all that you didn't know. I don't know how he did it. I've tried to copy it, but all my students say is, we have no idea what you're talking about on those tests. But what God wants us is to actually look at our lives and see that there has been some positive growth. If we want more growth, let's say thank you for what he has done. That's what he's saying here. Now look at your life. I look at my life. I mostly am miserable when I look at my life. I think, I am so not where I ought to be yet. Sin still lives in me. I recognize that. But as we talked about, I even talked about it the last time we were together. You know, when I look at my life about where I was heading before I knew the Lord and now where I am, oh, God has really transformed me. I am a new creature. My life has changed. I venture to say that would be true each and every one of our lives. We can look at our lives and say, yes, God, I thank you for the faith that I have in my life. Maybe small, but it's growing. I thank you for the love that I have in the lives of others, the concern I have for others. And if I don't, Lord, I need that more, but I can see something happening in my life. Let's not automatically dismiss our growth. Let's start off by thanking God, just as Paul did for the Ephesians, for the spiritual growth that we already have. But it's not enough. Never be satisfied, but start off by thanking God. That's the first principle of praying for spiritual growth. Here's the second one. When praying, we should ask God for the spiritual perception we desperately need, the spiritual understanding that we desperately need. This picks up in verse 17. It's where he says in verse, got to get new glasses here. I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him. He is asking that God would give them spiritual insight. Now, I'm reading here from the ESV. It says, capital S, spirit of wisdom. But in Greek, there's no capital. So that's an interpretive decision that the translators made. And interpreters are sort of split on this. Is it a capital S? Are they praying for the, is Paul praying for them to have the spirit of God give them wisdom and revelation? Or is it a disposition? May God give you an attitude, a spirit of wisdom and revelation. You know, it's a tough decision, but I lay, my opinion is that it's a small s, that it's a disposition. And the reason is, just in the first two, the verses just before this, verses 13 and 14, he's already said that they're sealed with the Spirit. If you read everything that Paul says, they're already indwelt by the Spirit, they're baptized by the Spirit, they're anointed by the Spirit according to 1 John. They are sealed with the Spirit according to Paul. We have the Holy Spirit. So he would not be praying for them to receive the Holy Spirit, even the spirit of wisdom and revelation, but rather a spirit of wisdom and revelation. What is wisdom? Wisdom is skill. And I would say he's asking them to have the skillful application of God's word. That's the spiritual insight they need. And revelation has to do with God's revelation, his disclosure of himself. Where do we find God's disclosure of himself? Well, we find it in general revelation, in creation. But for us, the best way for us to grasp it is right here. And so what he is asking for them to have a disposition of understanding God's word, God's revelation, and the skillful application of it in their lives. That's what spiritual insight is. He is asking them to, and why? What's the purpose of this wisdom and revelation? I love the next phrase. I'm going to give you my paraphrase of it. But it says, may he give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, or to know him better. He's saying we all need to pray for spiritual insight, skillful application of the word, and good understanding of the revelation of God in the Word, so we can know him better. It is through that, through revelation and wisdom, that we get to know him better. That's through our knowledge of the Word and our application of the Word in our life. And then he says, he goes on to ask for more spiritual enlightenment. If you see what he says next, he says, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you. So he says, pray for spiritual enlightenment too. He's praying for that spiritual disposition, that spiritual insight, and then enlightenment. The eyes, that's the gateway to the person, of your heart, that's the inner person. And so he is saying, may your eyes be opened, your heart be opened, and enlightened, and continue to be enlightened, is sort of what the grammar has to say. And it is saying, pray for that spiritual enlightenment. When does enlightenment like that come to us? Well, the very first time is when God opened our hearts to believe. When we trust in Jesus, that's spiritual enlightenment. It doesn't happen on our own. I love in Acts 16, Lydia, the Lord opened Lydia's heart to believe. That's the idea. So we need that spiritual enlightenment to believe. And secondly, enlightenment continues as we pray for it, just as Paul says here. Then enlightenment continues as we study God's word. He starts speaking into our lives as we read it and study it regularly. People always say, you know, I'm not growing. Well, I always say, if you're not growing, are you in the Word? Well, I'm just kind of bored with it. Well, okay, then don't grow. Because it's the choice of being in the Word or growing. You know, if you're not in the Word, you're not going to grow. If you are in the Word, we are going to grow. That's just how it is. That's the story of life. And so coming to know the Lord, praying for enlightenment, praying as we study God's Word, as we interact with God's people, God will speak into our lives with proper application. I think it's why we need to be in home groups, small groups. We need small groups because we need people to encourage us. So how does enlightenment happen? It's obviously a process. It doesn't happen instantaneously. It happens gradually over time. With all those ways, God opens our hearts to believe. When we come to know the Lord, He enlightens us. And then as we read His Word, He enlightens us more. As we pray, He enlightens us more. As we meet with God's people, He enlightens us more. It's sort of like when my in-laws, now with the Lord, when Eva and I got married, they left Chicago. That's where Eva's from. And they moved to rural Tennessee. And we'd go visit them, and they got no TV. Had no TV. They had a TV, but they couldn't get anything because there was no reception. But then they got those rabbit ears. Do you remember those? And they could get one station. One station, the ABC affiliate, that's what they could get. And then they went ahead and they decided, we're going to get an outside antenna. And now they could get three stations, but two of them were really fuzzy. And then Eva's dad really sprang for it. He got an antenna that was adjustable. There was this thing that you could move it around outside on the roof. And so you could point it at the different stations 90 miles away. And then you could have TV. The process of clarity came gradually. It didn't happen instantaneously. We expect to be spiritual giants the moment we believe, but there's a process that Paul is praying for here and calling us to pray for, which involves having the eyes of our heart enlightened. How do we do that? Remember, start with when the Lord opens our hearts to believe, and then after that, when we pray for it. And then after that, when we study the Word of God. And then after that, when we're among God's people. And if we keep doing those four things, guess what God's going to do? He's going to enlighten us. We're going to get the spiritual perception we desperately need. So, first step, what do we have to pray for? Well, we have to pray, praise God, give thanks. Remember this, the first step, give thanks. Give thanks for what He's already granted us, what He's already done in our lives. Second step, pray for spiritual perception. Pray for God to give us insight, give us enlightenment. That's what we need to be praying for. Here's the third one. You ready? When praying, we should expect God to give us the spiritual benefits we deeply desire. This is what we want. We want spiritual transformation to happen. We should expect God to answer our prayers. Part of praying is expecting God to answer. And so what can we expect? First of all, we can expect to know the hope of our calling. Look at verse 18. It says in the second half, it says, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which He has called you. The meaning of hope is a confident expectation. That's what a hope is. We use hope differently. Like, wow, this season, I hope to lose 20 pounds, please. That's far-fetched. It's not real. Okay? During this Passover season for me, all those macaroons, there's no way I'm losing 20 pounds. But a confident expectation is something that I am expecting. I am looking for it. That's the hope. And the calling is when He called us to know Him. When that call went out for us to believe and we responded by believing. He says, I want you to know the hope, expect to know the hope of your calling. This is really important because it is our hope that when he called us, one day we'll be with him. Our hope that we have since we've been called, that when he called us in the past, we now have a future hope. One day Jesus is returning. If we are alive when he returns, we're going to reign with him. We have a hope of our calling. We have a full expectation. A former colleague of mine who taught at Moody with me back, you know, when D.L. Moody started the school, he called me up this week, just out of the blue, I just want to catch up. And so we were chatting it up, and he started talking to me about politics. And I hate talking about politics, to be truthful. I just hate it. Because you never know what people are thinking, you know. And whatever I think, they're not going to be happy. So I just don't like talking about it. And he starts talking about how bad the world is. And I said, yeah, it's true. But I don't care. I mean, I want to do what I can in the world to do what's best for the world. I really want that. But my hope isn't in politicians or presidents. My hope is not, I always say, my hope's not in a Gentile president. My hope is in a Jewish king. That's what it is. That is the hope of our calling, that one day Jesus is going to reign. And so he wants us, as we pray for spiritual growth, spiritual benefits, we should know the hope of our calling. And we can also expect to understand the riches of his glorious inheritance. The riches of his glorious inheritance. You could see that there in verse 18. It says at the end, he says that you would know what is the hope to which he has called you to, and what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints or among the saints. He wants us to understand our inheritance. Now, Hebrews 1:2, Jesus is the heir of all things. The Lord Jesus is the one who is the heir. He is the inheritor of all things. So what is our inheritance? He, by his grace, shares his glorious inheritance with us. Now, I have a dear friend through many years, Jewish girl, and about 45 years ago, she came to faith in Jesus. Her dad was a very wealthy Jewish doctor in Philly. And when she came to faith, he said, I'm writing you out of the will. And she had some medical challenges, I would say, and she was never really going to be able to earn a great living. But he was writing her out of the will. He said the Kaddish prayer for her. He says, if you don't renounce this faith in Jesus, Kaddish is the prayer for the dead, I'm going to mourn over you and treat you as if you are dead and you're out of the will. And he thought she would acquiesce, but she said, Jesus means more to me. And so she stayed faithful and did not deny the faith. And then her dad, when he finally died, the will actually did specify that everything went to her brother. He received all of it. But her brother loved her. And because he loved her, he contacted her immediately and said, I am sharing the inheritance with you. We're splitting this. In fact, it belongs to us, not just to me. He gave her the inheritance that he had received. That's what the Lord Jesus does. He is the heir of all things. And because we are connected to him, he grants it to us. And the problem is, we don't know what it is. He wants us, Paul says, to pray that we understand what is the greatness of this inheritance that we're supposed to receive, that we have because we're united with the Lord Jesus. He wants us to understand what our glorious inheritance is. Now, I understand that because we don't grasp it. A number of years ago, Eva and I were flying back from, remember when it used to go fly places? Right. We were flying back from Orange County, California, and I'm sitting there next to Eva, and I'm saying, okay, so I just read about this, and because of Newport Beach, the planes that take off from John Wayne Airport actually fly almost vertically up because they have to get up high enough so that when they pass over Newport Beach, all the rich people aren't mad about the sound of the planes. And so it's kind of a very, very upward trajectory. And so we decided to... We never pay attention when the plane's taking off, but that day, we decided to pay attention. And as the plane is taking off, no joke, we're about, 100 feet off the ground, the right engine explodes, and the wing dips and almost hits the ground. And then the plane just gradually straightens out. Everyone around us, I mean, we heard this explosion, we saw the fire coming from the engine, and people are shrieking and crying. And that's, you know, that's a real test of your faith, don't you think? Am I going to shriek? I'm going to die. Actually, I thought, I'm going to see Jesus. I think maybe that's the first time I realized, yeah, I'm really a believer, you know? And I looked at Eva, and she's like, we're going to see the Lord. We thought we're going to die just right then. And I only had one moment of angst at that, you know, every time really goes slow when that happens. The angst was, I don't think the kids know where the will is. And they didn't. But the pilot comes on, we've been riding up that engine for a number of times and they kept saying there was nothing wrong with it. Ha! We're heading to LAX right now. And so we flew to LAX, and we landed with all the different emergency equipment and took another plane home. But here's the point. When I got home, I got out the will, and I got my kids there. This is where the will is, okay? Also, I typed up all the retirement stuff and everything that we had, and here's the ID, and here's the password, and this is the bank accounts that we have. And they're like, what are you doing? I said, I want you to know your inheritance. That's what I want you to know. If anything happens to Mom and me, which Eva was happy for because she had no idea what that stuff was either. But the point is, I wanted my kids to know their inheritance. God wants us to know our glorious inheritance. And we have a great one because we're united with Jesus. We get to live with him forever. We get to rule with him, which I don't know what I'm going to rule over, but the Bible says we're going to rule with him. We're going to judge angels. I would like to do that. You know, your wing's a little dusty. I don't know what I'm going to do. But I want to have a better understanding of that glorious inheritance that I have with him forever so I can glorify him for it. So what he is saying here is that we can expect God as we pray so that we'll know the hope of our calling, we'll know understand the riches of his glorious inheritance that he shares with us. We can expect to experience the immeasurable greatness of his power. We can pray and we can expect to experience his spiritual power in our lives presently, right now. We can expect to have that now. Look at verse 19. It describes his power. It says in verse 19, and what he's praying that we would understand what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe according to the working of his great might. The immeasurable power, greatness of his power, according to the working of his great might. This is, how do I describe it? This stacking of words of power. Whether it's power, the word that's used there, of ability, immeasurable power, which means surpassing beyond everything. Working is energia, which is power in operation. Strength of his might is literally what it says, translated great might here, referring to God's sovereign strength and his supernatural power. This is a stacking of words. It is saying that we have tremendous power and we can expect God to work in our lives with power. So often we think of the normal believer's life as failure. The Bible here says that when we pray for it, God will make his power work in us. This immeasurable power. We can expect it. Now, when he says it, he demonstrates that power. I want you to look at the demonstration that's found there. It's shown in the past through the resurrection and ascension of the Lord Jesus. That power, he says, it is that he worked in Messiah, in Christ, when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places. You want to know how powerful God is? He demonstrates it because it was shown in the past at the resurrection and ascension of Jesus. There is nothing more powerful, when I think of it, than God raising Jesus from the dead. That's power. Amen. That's what he shows it. Now, last week on Easter Sunday, a senator from the United States Senate, who is also a pastor who should know better, apparently someone from his staff, not him, but it was on his Twitter account, put out this statement on Twitter that there is something more surpassing in power than the resurrection of Jesus. It said the meaning of Easter is more transcendent than the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Whether you are a Christian or not, through helping others, we're able to save ourselves. Good grief. I'd like to see me try to save myself. Maybe you, not me. And also, what can be more transcendent in power than the resurrection of the Lord Jesus? There's nothing. We think of power. Do you remember Mount St. Helens? I remember when that happened. I'm old enough to remember when that happened. When Mount St. Helens blew off, we think of natural disasters, earthquakes, hurricanes, tornadoes. They're all so powerful. On May 18th, 1980, Mount St. Helens erupts and is probably the most powerful example of, in my lifetime, of nature's power. It blows up. The explosion ripped 1,300 feet off the top of the mountain. It had the force of 100 million tons of TNT. It had about the power of 500 Hiroshimas. That's how powerful it was. 60 people were evaporated instantly. There was a blast of 300 degree heat traveling at 200 miles an hour as this blew off. People were killed as far as 16 miles away. It leveled 150-foot Douglas firs as far as 17 miles away. A total of 3.2 billion board feet of lumber was destroyed, enough to build 200,000 three-bedroom houses. That's power. And let me just say, relative to the resurrection of Jesus, nothing. Nothing. That's the power we have. And then the power to have him ascend to heaven, that's pretty amazing. That's how God demonstrates his power, through the resurrection and ascension of Jesus. And that is, by the way, the power that's already in us. You want more power in your walk with the Lord? Don't look elsewhere. We've got it. The Holy Spirit, the power that raised Jesus from the dead, dwells in us. So God demonstrates his power this way. It is also shown in the future through the lordship of the Lord Jesus over all creation, right? It says here in verse 21 and 22 that he is seated in the heavenly places far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, above every name there is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. He is ruler over all. He's ruler over all now, but people don't recognize it. But there is coming a day when he is going to rule over all. There is no one that will not bow the knee, both among his enemies and his friends. He is going to rule over all. That's how God demonstrates his power. And then it says, not only that, but it's shown in the present through his headship over the universal congregation, the universal body of the Messiah. It says that in verse 22, he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. That's us. He takes his power. He's ruling over the church, and he takes his power and rules, empowers us. His power is over all and in all. Isn't that amazing? That's in us. We are his fullness. He is the one that fills us with power. We can actually experience his power, the power that raised the Messiah from the dead. How so? When he indwelt us by his Spirit when we came to faith, right? We can experience his power when he transforms us by his Spirit. We can experience his power when he gave us spiritual gifts to serve him. We can use power to serve him. It's amazing. You think spiritual gifts, they're not so powerful. Listen, I know about the power of spiritual gifts because I see it in others. If I preach the very sermon that Billy Graham would preach, I could say all I want in the Southern accent, the buses will wait. You know, I could do that. I could have the organ play just as I am. I could preach the same message, because once when he preached in New York, I helped write the message. I was on the team. And I heard, when he's preaching, I'm like, I wrote that. I heard it, at least part of it. I'm like, if I did the same thing, you know how many people would come up? None. They'd say, what is this guy talking about? But the spiritual gift of evangelism was so strong in Billy Graham. When he'd say that, people, the Spirit of God would work and people would stand up and get saved. Amazing. They'd come forward. God has all this power in us. We can expect him to work in us. Well, I just want to give you, you say, Rydelnik, you've been saying so many things. Can you simplify? Here's the simple. If you want to get what I've been saying today, here it is. Are you ready? When we pray for spiritual growth, thank God, ask God, expect God. Amen. Thank God, ask God, expect God. That's it. Thank God, ask God, expect God. That's what we're supposed to pray about. Well, now what? Now what do we do? Thank God for at least one growing area of your life. When you pray, thank God for at least one. Write it down. God, I want to thank you for that. Also, ask God to give us an insight, to help us understand our spiritual wealth in Messiah. And third, when you pray this week, ask God to share his power in one particular needy area. That's what we need. Let me just pull it all together here. William Randolph Hearst, remember him? Rosebud, that was based on his life, that famous movie. He was a publishing magnate. He invested a fortune in collecting art treasures from all around the world. And one day, Hearst found a description of some valuable item that he desperately wanted. So he sent his agent out to find this piece of artwork. They spent months searching for it. They couldn't locate it. Finally, after months, after they had searched all the treasures of the world, they came to William Randolph Hearst and they told him that they found it. It was in Hearst's warehouse. He had been searching frantically for treasures he already owned. Had he even just read his catalog, he would have known how much treasure he had, and he would have saved himself a lot of money and trouble. You know, we are searching for spiritual power, and we need to be praying for spiritual growth, and that God would use the power that already is in us to transform us into the people he wants us to be. Would you pray that? Let's pray together. God, we thank you that you have worked in our lives, and oh Lord, thank you that you have given us the power of the resurrection in our lives. So we're grateful for that. We're also asking you to transform us by the power of the Holy Spirit, that as we read your word and obey your word, as we look at your word, that you would transform us by the power of the Spirit. And also, Lord, we expect you to open our eyes to understand and to be transforming us in our lives. And we want to give you all the praise for our Lord Jesus, who makes all of this possible. In the name of Jesus, our Messiah. Amen.
So grateful for the life-changing Word of God. Now, let's ask God to help us put those now what statements into action this week. We'd love to see you this Wednesday night for one of our prayer meetings on any of our campuses at 7 p.m. or you can join us online for that as well. The details are all available at harvestnow.info. And I want to invite you back next Sunday. We'll be back here 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. Central Time. And if you're ready, and if you live in the Chicagoland area, we would absolutely love to see you in person at one of our campuses. You are loved.